Record. Okay. Well, thanks for joining me to have a lovely discussion about our sacred rage. I did make some slides, so we'll kind of go through those and then we'll see what kind of time we have for discussion after. And I have a couple kind of exercises we could do, depends on how comfortable you feel. So we'll see. Oh, I'm going to let Cynthia in too. So there we go. Which is great. We'll just give her a moment, and I am going to hit my share screen. It's like I have to relearn it every time. What buttons do I press? Welcome, Cynthia.
Hi. Sorry I'm late.
So, okay, we are just getting started because we were chatting. So welcome. Okay. This is what I'm titling it, Sacred Rage, Befriending and Tending to Our Inner Fire. So, yeah, because that's really ultimately what it is. You guys already know this about me, but this is just for people who watch the recording. So, blah, blah, blah. Okay, so here's some of my intentions is that we would be curious at least about befriending. Oops, Mayo's here too. We would be curious about befriending our anger, at the very least. If I could inspire you to befriend this experience in you, that would be awesome. And pr also increasing our tolerance for the actual sensation of anger, because that's the part we're avoiding, the actual bodily sensation of what it feels like to be angry. And then to cover, just to talk about what sacred rage is and what it isn't. And perhaps starting with, I think I'll start with my own kind of maybe why this is personal for me. So I'm calling it the good girl and her reservoir of rage. So, and I got that title from Dr. Sarno. Welcome, Ayu. So he talks about the reservoir. So people who identify with being good slash perfect have a larger reservoir of rage than other people. And this is our unconscious reservoir of rage, which is of course going to erupt on all over the place, possibly, or we're going to really stuff it and turn it against ourselves. So I really kind of like that concept of this reservoir of rage that we don't access. So that's one of the kind of things I'd like to talk a bit about today. I definitely identified with being a good girl. In my family, my dad was the only one allowed to be angry, and his anger was definitely explosive and scary. And I, you know, one of my biggest memories is at the supper table, and I would get in trouble for not eating my onions. This was a regular occurrence. I don't know what it was about the onions, and also that was the hill I was willing to die on, which is kind of surprising to me. I mean, I love them now, but as a kid, I still just wouldn't eat them, even though it turned into these big family dramas. And my dad would lose it, and then my mom would try to make him feel better, and me and my brother and sister would eventually leave the table, and he would always come upstairs to my room after, and then it would turn into you had to forgive him for that eruption. It was just this cycle all the time. So I really didn't befriend anger in myself. I would have said I just wasn't angry. Luckily, I had kids and learned that that wasn't in fact true. But in those early years, I thought for sure I just wasn't, like, I didn't get angry. I was just a really nice person. So having to discover that in myself has been quite a journey. Yeah, so I still would say I was not much of an eruptor. I was more of a stuffer. So yeah, that piece, and we can talk more about that. So I want to start with my favorite visual, which I've used in other webinars, so you've probably seen it. But the change triangle, Hilary Jacobs Hendel, I highly recommend her book if you haven't read it. But even if you don't, just the, and you can actually get her free. She's got all sorts of free resources on her website. And I made this one, but you can get hers and download them. And this is a brilliant tool for helping you kind of track your own, well, all your emotions, but we're going to particularly use it for anger today. So we all have core emotions: fear, anger, sadness, disgust, joy, excitement, and sexual excitement. These just happen. And our ability to be with them, experience them, and when we're kids, to have them mirrored by somebody so somebody can say, "Oh, I see that you're really angry," and we can learn to be okay with that in our body, helps us move into an open-hearted state. So one of the ways I think that we're going to know that we're in a healthy core emotion is that the being with it, the feeling it, the doing whatever it is we're going to do with it is going to move us to an open-hearted state. We are going to be more open in the world, calm, curious. So that's kind of like the litmus test of what we're looking for. If we end up in our defensive strategies, or if our anger is a defense, we are not going to move into an open-hearted state. So I really like just that visual, so you can track, okay, am I having a core emotion of anger, or is this my defensive strategy? Did something else happen and now I'm in defensive mode and I'm raging, or that's different than the core emotion, which just happens, which is really about our own boundaries being violated, our no not being listened to. It's in service of life, that core emotion. Let me think if I want to say anything else about that. So we have core emotions and we have a defensive kind we're going to talk about on our next slide. And also, just to say that part of the healing journey is doing the developmental tasks that we missed. So if we never learn to work with emotions in our family, especially anger, because most of us, if you look on here, most of us, it's anger and sexual excitement. Those are the two that are suppressed in our culture, and then they go real sideways. So we have to, that's one of the tasks that never goes away. Becoming a mature human being, we're going to have to learn how to be with our emotions. They are what color our world and make us alive. We don't actually want to aim for to be somebody, at least I don't think so, to be somebody who's just kind of, not to anything. We want to feel the full gamut of all of them because that's the human experience. We just want to learn how to be with them so we're not stuffing them or dumping them on other people. So yeah, we have to do that developmental task. Here is some of the common defensive strategies I thought we could kind of look at, and you can get these right off Hillary Jacobs Hendel's website also. So you might look through some of these. So if we are not with our core emotion of anger, we will get bumped up the triangle, often into guilt, shame, and anxiety, which will push us then into our defensive strategies. So sometimes that happens because as a kid, if you felt extreme anger, perhaps even hatred towards a parent, but it was conflicting because you also love them, that can push you up into a defensive strategy because now you have to defend against these emotions because they're confusing, which is really what anxiety is that two things can two conflicting stories that end up pushing us into our defenses. So then we go into all of these smiling instead of being angry. Some of these are classic, the way women do it, especially, but appeasing instead of being direct. I put in here also that our def one defensive strategy would be for, I think especially for women, but is that we would feel sadness instead of anger. So as a way to avoid our core emotion of anger, we end up being sad because that's more socially acceptable for women, but it does lead to an acceptance of what's happening, whereas our no will take us into a firmer a no, like I'm a no to that. But the sadness will generally make us more accepting and kind of lead to a sense of powerlessness often, which is more preferred in general, right? So kind of knowing what we do in our defensive strategies can really help us track if there was a core emotion that happened and I missed it, or I didn't, you know, I didn't feel it, I didn't name it. Now I'm calling it something else, or I'm in, you know, we might, for instance, call it frustration instead of naming it anger, which might also put us into our defensive strategies. So just kind of looking at these, seeing where you notice yourself. And the trick really is to see it, one, to go to notice I'm in my one of my defense, my ways of defending against my actual core emotions. So the what I'm going to do is get curious about what the emotion was that put me into that. And I'm going to move my way back down the triangle. I'm going to find my core emotion. I'm going to feel it. Let that move through me, see if I can say yes to it. You know, make space for it. That's and then track if I'm moving up eventually into the open-hearted state. Does that make sense, everyone? Okay. So let's move into a little bit about anger in the body. And of course, I'm going to direct you to Gabor Mate's work. Also, I put these at the end, but Dr. Sarno, he really wrote about the back in particular and anger and the connection between people who, even if their back was, you know, disc related, all these things that would show up in an X-ray, there was no correlation between the pain someone felt and the actual X-ray. And he found that the people who were able to name the fact that they had emotions they weren't working with got healed no matter what the X-ray said, or got felt better, didn't have the pain. So he's worth kind of reading. But and Gabor Mate, of course, his book When the Body Says No is all about when we don't say no, our body will. So when the aggressive energy of anger is diverted inward, the immune system becomes confused. Our physiological defenses no longer protect us or may even turn mutinous, attacking the body. So I put some particular pictures because these can be a little more familiar with where we might be storing our anger that we're not in touch with. Classic ones are shoulders and neck. In Rosen method, they would call that these are the lid muscles. So this is how we hold everything in, which makes sense. So if we, especially as kids, needed to contain those kind of extreme, what felt like extreme emotions, and we didn't have any help with how to navigate it, or someone else was taking up all the air in the room, and we needed to become smaller, this is how we do it. We hold everything in. We can tighten our, you know, our voice to keep from erupting that way. We can shove it all down, and we use all our muscles. We can have high blood pressure from holding everything in, constricting. So we kind of want to get curious about, in Rosen, they would say you injure yourself where you're already holding. So if you are already keeping everything locked down and then you do something and tweak it and you think, oh, I must have just put my shoulder out, or I have what's the one frozen shoulder, for instance, must have just kind of happened all of a sudden. Well, chances are we've been shoving stuff in there for a really long time, holding ourselves back, keeping ourselves contained, and then eventually we've injured ourselves because we were already holding there. So just to be curious about that, the links between all sorts of autoimmune things, which is why women tend to have way more autoimmune issues than men do, because we tend to turn that anger in. But I also think that the good boy slash good girl, the loyal son archetype, is just as skilled at that as the good girl is. Hey, good, makes sense. Do I want to say anything about that? Oh, I also wanted to talk a little bit about posture. And that also it can be if we needed to make ourselves less threatening to the person who was, say, taking up all the room, we might have a posture that says, don't stick your neck out, keep yourself small. We can co literally come into an experience with us a posture of appeasing, like offering someone the jugular. You know, if I come in a defenseless position, then I'm less likely to be, you know, destroyed by that person. But we can also have a defensive posture where we can, you know, like birds do, you can make yourself appear bigger than you are. So that can also be a way that we are compensating for stuff too, is if I enter the room and I can look big, then I don't have to, then that can do the work for me in a sense. So we can, our posture can really play a role in this also. Part of my story, I think what cued me to some of this too was my relationship with my parents. When my parents would come and visit, there was a year period where they would come and visit where I would put my back out every time, or I would go totally, I would lose my voice. I would have total laryngitis. And I remember thinking that I'm not that quick of a study because it took me at least the, like a series of visits for me to kind of put that connection together. But the effort I was doing to keep to be that pleaser, the appeaser, to not rock any boats, to just put up with it, my motto would be just suck it up. The cost of that to my body was I was breaking down. And I never got sick or lost my voice. And it would just be this either right before they came or right after they left. So I started to get curious about what I was doing to myself in order to show up in the way that I was, you know, the safety role I was taking. The repression of anger and the unregulated acting out of it are both examples of the abnormal release of emotions that is at the root of disease. If in repression, the problem is a lack of release, acting out consists of an equally abnormal suppression of release and alternating with unregulated and exaggerated venting. Both repression and rage, the acting out of it, represent a fear of the genuine experience of anger. Healthy anger is an empowerment and a relaxation. So I'm not sure if you guys use anger as a way to relax. Part of your late Friday night relaxing strategy, but now you can. Well, maybe we'll see how we can do that. And I also wanted to kind of bring attention to that acting out, that which is what we usually associate with anger. So we don't want to do it because we don't want to be like that guy. That's actually not in relationship. That's not healthy anger. That's not a person in touch with their anger. That's about our domination, our drive to dominate and a power over another. So, but we have a fear that we're going to do that. If we get in touch with our anger, we're just going to start erupting everywhere. That is not anger. So suppression or exploding on people, neither one of those is being in touch with anger. Okay. So let's, this is why we're here. The sacred rage. This is the two sides of the goddess. This is the way you meet the goddess in yourself, really. So let's start with, I wanted to start with sacred sexuality, for instance. So as we saw in our triangle, our sexual excitement is a core emotion also. And since most of us, I'm going to guess, did not get taught or we're not, we did not have that received in ourselves, that also went underground. But it is also an instinctual embodied thing that we have access to. So sacred sexuality, when you get in touch with that life force that is your own pleasure, basically your deep yes to life, it's everything you are a yes to. That can show up in the way you eat a strawberry, in how you love a plant, how you pet a dog, how you know, and in that open-hearted state, it has nothing to do with going and having sex with people. That could be one way that you express it, but we don't have to say, I don't have to tell you that if you're in touch with your sacred sexuality, you won't go rape people. That's inherent in the, well, of course you won't. That's not a sacred use of sexuality. So same with sacred rage. Inherent in the rage is a sacredness about your own holy no. It has nothing to do with whether you express it or you go and, you know, do something as an action because of it. You don't ever need to, actually. It's just you being in touch with your own life force that says no. If you don't have a no, you can't really have a solid yes. You'll never know what you're actually for if you don't know what you're a no to. You need both of these aspects of the goddess, and they say that's why they are that's why they've gone sideways, and then they come out in the culture in really unhealthy ways. Because if people are in touch with these two things, they are less fuckwithable, right? People who know what they're a yes to and what they're a no to cannot be controlled the same way. They can't be, in a sense, pushed around either. Like, it's like they know who they are and they know what they're about and they stand in their own power. And that's why those have not been really accepted in our culture. Yeah. So I really like that. And you could also look at it like your no, protects your yes and is fiercely protective of it. So when we have these two, we have a way of going through the world in our own power, really. So let's see. I want to just see what my, in case I don't remember. Okay, what else do I want to say about this? So again, this no is not dependent on acting. You don't have to do anything with it. It's not meant to be gotten rid of. I don't need a catharsis. I don't need to release it somehow. I don't have to do anything with it except feel that ferociousness that is mine in my own body and to make space for it. And I think that when we were kids, and this kind of automatically, same with the sacred sexuality, when that embodied experience showed up and we didn't see a healthy container or we didn't have anybody recognize it, we got frightened of that in ourselves. And then if the adult around you is also frightened about that in themselves and in you, well, of course you're going to have to pack that shit up. So, but what if people hadn't been? What if you could have been met with a mirror that was deeply in touch with theirs as well, so they could recognize it in you, and they weren't threatened by it, or they could, nurture it. They could help you have boundaries around it. They could, I don't know. It just might have been a whole different experience. So, this is. You can also, I didn't put the expletives on here, but they can definitely be your fuck no, your hell no. these are your, and this is, and I like the posture for like when you get in touch with that, it is a pushing away and a no, but it's not a way out there kind of thing, because that kind of disempowers it a bit. It's a right close boundary of this is, I say no. I'm a no to that. I'm in my no, but it's the I that says no. And being in touch with that is just a really empowering thing. This no will not harm another. This is not, it's in service to life. It's deeply protective of the innocence in you and in another. It will not harm by its nature, same as sacred sexuality. There's nothing harmful about that. And it is a life force. It's an energy that runs through you that is deeply pleasurable and relaxing. So Gabor might use different words, but he's tracking the same thing. It's your inner ferocity. It roots you in what you deeply know, your own truth. And you can experiment with it. We can change our minds. We can be a no to something. We can take in more information, and then maybe we're a yes to it. We get to play around with that and change our minds. It's not pain. So when people think that they anger causes pain in them, or it's not painful. It's not a painful energy. And the reason why it's first and foremost most for you, it informs you about what you deeply care about, is because if you attach it to the outcome, or if by me getting in touch with my no, I now need you to change, or I need it to be different, or I need something to happen, I need to convince you or get something through to you, I'm now in the realm of codependence, because now I'm needing that to change in order to validate my experience of no. I don't need you to validate it. You don't have to agree with it. It's not about you. It's about me. I might, by being in touch with that energy in myself, also get some inspiration about what I want to do with it. If I want to make a change, or if I want to speak to somebody directly, if I want to do something with that, but it is not dependent on that. And I don't need an outside validation for it. So I think it helps me disconnect from that codependent self that's deeply dependent on the response of someone else to validate who I am. You don't see Callie there really super worried about that in her wielding of her knives. Let's see. So it's in service to life. We don't have to heal or rise above it. Let me see if I had anything else I wanted to say about that. There are so many things. It also, I said that, but it does connect you to what you care about. And I'm going to give you an exercise for that at the end that can help you kind of flesh that out. But that is the thing about it. It really does teach us I'm angry because I care. I might care about myself or about you or both, but it connects me to what I deeply care about. This is a quote from Maya Luna. This is a little bit long, but I think it's applicable. Sexual energy divorced from true presence and the sacred is the dominant paradigm we see of fast food porn eroticism. It's mental and rooted in objectification. The same is true for the dominant paradigm of anger. Imagine the vital life force energy of embodied anger unified with true presence. It is undeniably wed to the sacred. Sacred rage is effectively taking back the purity of what the actual life force energy of anger is about. It's the sacred protector of life, mine and others. The passionate no to the forces that seek to harm the sacred innocent of life and sacred matter and immanence. Sacred rage is the love of life and the love of truth. It rises up from the earth into the vessel of your body as an intelligent expression of life force, much like sacred Eros. Like sacred Eros, sacred rage is a frequency of the goddess, passionate life force energy that contains essential wisdom, intelligence, and profound connection to the sacred heart of life itself. To reclaim this energy as it wants to move and flow through your body is to fall in love with life. So what would it do for us if we had that view of it instead of suppression or, getting rid of it? But what if I could have this relationship to this intelligence in myself, my own boundaried self? I often kind of think of it as I have now access to this presence, this life force in me. I'm going to imagine it beside me, but it's like my own, I don't know, warrior woman, my own Kali, who's constantly in a state of no. And I can just draw on her and use that. This is a good time for my no. I feel like I have this access to this place in me that holds that line. So this is my other. Look at our, look at this panther. And lately, he's playing. Okay. Yeah. Look at the eyes. In case we're going to do some angry eyes later. And I've been pondering how the fear we have of the instinctual self. So those core emotions are, I think, coming from our instinctual self. And both, in the reading I've done, both Freud and Jung felt like the instinctual self was kind of the problem. And if you grew up in the church at all, the instinctual self was definitely the problem. It is not to be trusted. You can't even trust your heart, let alone whatever's arising from your instincts. And the best we can hope for is to be in charge of it with our ego. And we contain it, and that's what we do with it. And I was thinking, once recently how you don't hear about a panther in the forest that just went a little berserk one night and accidentally killed a whole bunch of things and then, came to town and said, "I'm so sorry about that. I don't know what came over me. I just lost it." Like they're always in there, like inherent in their instinctual self is control and that power and that like intention. They're not out of control. In fact, they say all the beings can eat at the watering hole at the same time until it's time for dinner time. And then they just do what's they take what they need. The only time it goes crazy is if they've been mistreated or locked up or there's something wrong. And I think that's the same for us. Unless it's there's something wrong with it or it's been mistreated or bound up, it's you can trust it. And the difference would be that my healthy adult self can act on behalf of this in myself. So I don't think that when we get in touch with these energies in ourselves that it has anything to do with being out of control. I think that's a misuse of that, and that's when it's been caged and mistreated. But our beautiful, ferocious panther energy is reliable. And it has that, like, don't fuck with me. So if you could have both of those, I'm open to life and also don't fuck with me. You got both of the got both sides. So anyway, that's really resonating for me. And also just to remind everyone that what we're after is the felt sense of our anger of this life force. We don't want that, in the intellectual idea. We want to experience what that's like in our body, the felt sense. When you think of him in the forest, it's like with rippling muscles, and that's, it's like a felt energy being in that one. So keep in mind that could be your good image for your sacred rage. That beauty right there. For if we do not allow the organic, sane, natural arising of the life force energy of anger that automatically and intelligently arises anytime we are abused, harmed, abandoned, or betrayed, we will internalize the experience or the voice of the one who harmed us and use it to harm ourselves from within. That's a really important quote, I think. Okay, I want to say a little bit about some of the difference maybe between our adult anger and our wounded child work with our little ones. So we can have a backlog of undigested emotions. So we can maybe have, and again, this would not be what I would consider sacred rage, but our anger that's bubbling over. And can be left, really left over from our childhood. And sometimes what we might need as the healthy adult is when we go back to do that wounded child work, our little wounded one might actually need us to stand in our ferocity on their behalf. It might require us to say to that little one, "I see that you are so angry. Is there anything that you need me to do about that? Do you want me, is there anything, how can I help you with that? If you'd like that, or what would maybe what would that one have wanted? Do you want me to go talk to that person?" And I mean this in an inner experience. You don't have to do this on the outside unless that seems important, but in the inner experience of talking to the one who abused them or in IFS, they take that you can get physical with whatever it is they're reacting to. So, but just to say that we're going to have kind of a both and we want to be in our adult self working with our no, but we also do have to go back and help the ones of us that are stuck in some kind of response in our childhood. And we are going to have to work with our little angry parts and see what they want us to know about their experience. So that's a really important piece. I think we can often think because in the adult realm now, well, I'm not mad at my parents. They did the best they could, but we could have young parts that absolutely are. And so we want to be willing to go back there and ask them and not put our adult logic on their experience. We want to say, what was that like for you? We have, if that change triangle, if what would have made the difference is somebody seeing the state we were in and naming it and helping us with that, that's what we're going to go do on behalf of them now. I have to let the cat out of my closet. He sleeps in the basket and he wants out now. Knew that would happen. And so anyway, that's another piece of it, is going back and doing that. And but can imagine bringing that panther energy, that ferocity, that's going to go back and say no on behalf of that one who's going to stand in between them and the other and say an absolute hell no, or fuck no, that should have never happened to you. I'll tell you a quick experience of the cats. Okay, when I did a vision quest with Animas Valley Institute, I had gone, you're out in the desert by yourself, and I was doing, kind of doing some of my own work for these 3 days and nights that you're out there. And I was it occurred to me as I was out there, I had this experience of when I was like 14. I came back from a youth event. And I remember being in the kitchen of our house and saying sorry to my dad for being a, I don't, what I considered a rebellious teen, an angry teen, and saying sorry. And so I'm in the middle of the desert and I have this thought of like, what the hell? I had every right to be angry at that. I should have never, had to go and apologize. It wasn't me. That was a proper response for what had happened to me with my dad. Anyway, so I was kind of taking it back. I wanted a do-over, and I told the universe I was not sorry. I take that back. I'm not sorry that I was difficult or whatever in those years. Anyway, when you come back from that, you tell the guides your story and they mirror back your experience. So I was sharing how I took back my sorry, that I wasn't sorry. And one of the guides after, she said, she just looked at me and she said, "And that thing with your dad, fuck yeah." And I just started bawling. And I had never heard the F-bomb used in such a therapeutic manner. But it was that like validation of somebody just saying, and like it was her no on behalf of my 14-year-old that can, it still moves me, that no one did for me. So that, that experience of being able to go back and say, and fuck no, that should have never happened, can be all that, that's all we needed. It doesn't have to be done differently. You don't need life to have gone differently. You just get to bring that ferocious one back there and rewrite some of that. And it makes a difference in your present. So yeah, we're living our no so that we can more fully live our yes. We need them both. And I don't know about you, but I want to be a full yes to my own life. I want to live it as fully and enthusiastically as I can. And I'm going to need to know what I'm a hell no to for that to work. So here's some books that I have drawn on, like Gabor Mate, Hilary Jacobs Hendel, Maya Luna. You can get her free Sacred Rage book if you go onto her website. Also, a great one is Rage Becomes Her by Sarora Shamali. If you want to get in touch with your rage, that'll do it. That one is chocked full of statistics and ways that, especially for women, how we have not been in touch with our anger. It's really good. And Dr. Sarno also, he's got a variety of them, but for back pain and yeah. An inability to articulate anger is recognized as a significant component of both depression and anxiety. So, by Sarora Shamali. So, even naming it, not that long ago, I was having trouble sleeping and I was thinking, what the heck is, and I had this thought, oh, I'm angry. And as soon as I said, I'm angry, I slept like a baby. So, I think sometimes even just naming it, that's what's happening here. So what we want to do is work with that sensation of anger so that when it occurs, we can recognize what's happening, we can feel it, make space for it, and then decide if we need to act on behalf of it. So it is that actual sensation that freaked us out as kids. And so when that shows up in our body, Often that's what's happening. Our parts are reacting to that sensation. So if we do practices that help us tap into the sensation and stay with it, build our tolerance of it, then when you're actually out in the world and anger hits, you're going to be able to make space for it and stay with it instead of stuffing or unloading it on somebody. And again, in all of it, we're after wholeness, not perfection. This is, sorry, I have a cat that needs to get out now. Okay, go. I should have not let him in, but I did. Okay, so yes, wholeness, not perfection. Okay, we're going to do a couple of exercises, and there's your panther to remind you. Maya Luna has some great exercises that she calls the push. And whether we do one or not, or I just talk about them, is what would you guys like to do? Do an exercise or understand how to do one? Or both? Do it.
Both doing
Yeah.
it.
Okay, let's do it. So we're going to do one. I'll just say, okay, so here's a journal option so that you could do later. This is, she did this with me and I found it really helpful. So you write down everything you're angry about. Can be from the past or now, and there's no censoring it. There's nothing petty. All of it matters. You put it all on the paper. And then you see if when you look at it, you can tell what it is you deeply care about. And that for me was a big, oh my God, like I really do care about this stuff. So then it just helps you to see it's not, these are, this is what you deeply care about. That's important to protect in yourself. So we want to get good at having difficult conversations. A number of years ago, I realized that was a skill I did not have and that I needed to get good at difficult conversations. Tolerating discomfort of our anger and someone else's, learning how to tolerate, to be in that sense of discomfort, that's important. A couple of lines to say is practice saying, I'm angry, or I say no, I say no. I'm a no to that. Or I'm angry, I care. And you don't even have to say them to anybody, just say them to yourselves. And if there's someone you can practice with, we did this exercise where we just spent two minutes saying to the other person on a Zoom room, I'm angry. I'm angry. And the other person just said, you're angry. You're angry. And I found it really great for tracking myself to see how open I could stay in the face of someone else's anger. And for me being willing to say I'm angry to someone else and nobody's doing anything about it. I'm not fixing it. That person's not fixing it. It doesn't have to go anywhere. It's just true. So having that kind of experience of this is just true of me. I'm angry. I don't have to do anything about that. Is a really great experience. And then Maya Luna has a Sacred Rage playlist on Spotify that you can access free, you can access. And one of the things that you can do is just put on some music for a certain amount of time and just move to it. Or one of the things would be to bounce, like to just bounce with it and to feel you can start with something you're angry about. You can say, I'm so angry about that, and see if you can bring the sensation up, but then just let it be there and move. So do these kind of practices to tend your inner fire. So I'm going to tell you about the push, and then we're going to do it for 2 minutes, and then we'll have a few minutes perhaps to talk about how that is for us. Okay. I'm not going to be able to show you on the floor, but I highly recommend you doing it on the floor. So if you want to turn your camera off and do that, that's what I recommend. If that doesn't work, you can also sit on, do this on your lap or on a wall. So what we're going to do is put a song on for two minutes, and we are going to practice that ferocious panther energy, really. You're going to be on all fours or against the wall or your lap, and you're going to maybe think first about something you're angry about. It doesn't have to be anything big, just something you're kind of angry about. And just let yourself feel that I'm angry. And you want to push, you want to feel, this is why it's great on all fours, because we're going to be pushing against the floor. So the movement kind of is as you go down toward the floor, you breathe in And as you come up, you're gonna do the panther. You're gonna say, and you can use angry eyes like panther. And then you're gonna go back down, breathing in. And when you come back up, push against the floor and just do, and just really feel your own ferocity. And then when we're done, after the 2 minutes, I'll turn the music off and you just stop and stay still. And see if you can feel that ferocity in your body, your actual life force that's deeply protective of you, that deeply cares and is your own fuck no. And see if what you feel in your body with that. Notice if tears show up, and you can just ask your tears maybe to even move aside and see if you can just stay with the sensation of anger, of rage. Does that make sense? Okay, I'm going to stop my share. Well, I guess I could have done that already. And then, I'm going to share my music instead here. Okay, so we'll do it for 2 minutes and then we will, I'll stop it. And then you'll just be still for a moment and feel it. Okay. Assuming everyone hears that. Yes, breathe in. And you go down. And you push, you come up. You can use your angry eyes and breathe out. Feel your own ferocity. One more minute. Okay, just stay where you are and just see what you can feel of your own life force. See what you can open to. Can even take that energy and bathe it all over yourself if that feels right for you. You can thank it. And then, if you're comfortable with it and that feels complete for you, I know it's a fast practice, you can bring yourself back on camera and we can have a few moments to just maybe share how was that for you. Who feels like a panther? Mayu does. Does anyone have anything, any comments, anything you want to share, any questions, anything?
Well, for me, that felt amazing. I think I just started with my face, and I think it was so interesting that after a couple times I could feel my pelvis sort of like clenching in and really feeling it. Then I felt it in my hands, and my feet started curling, and then I felt really relaxed after that. And then I was just sort of going in a circle, and just letting it come out when I hit the front of the circle. And it just felt great to feel really relaxed, but just really, really present. Yeah, it felt
Yeah.
really great.
Beautiful. Thank you.
For me, I've never done anything like that before. So
Yeah.
interesting. It was, I noted it was interesting, or what was of interest to me was what came to my mind as to what I'm angry about. And yeah, a lot of it directed towards myself, actually. And I guess my inability or not having had that strong no, or the solid no. So yeah, it's interesting. Think I'll try that again.
Do it. So go to our playlist, pick a, do it for 4 minutes or pick a, and just, let yourself be angry about something, really feel into that. And then partway through, you almost want to drop the story and just feel the sensation. So start with whatever gets you there, but then eventually kind of let that even la even that go. Just to be with your own life force, that which is deeply protective of you and does say no on your behalf and has that fierce quality, and let it just hum through you.
I was gonna share that it was also very different than anything I've experienced before. And at first, I found the anger in my body to be very spiky and almost like not just being with it, but almost like I had to do something with it. And then the more I did it, it became less about that and just letting it flow in my body. And it did feel very empowering. And that's when it did start to feel like a bit of relaxation was starting.
That is so great. And even to notice that at first it's like I should get rid of this. This needs to go somewhere. And then, but it doesn't. It truly doesn't, which I think is a really fascinating thing about that. It's for you. Yeah. Wow. Thank you.
I felt super uncomfortable. Lots of resist, not because of the practice, but just resistance to feeling that anger.
Yeah.
So, I don't know. I couldn't quite give myself permission to really get in touch with that. It may help to do the journaling exercise first, maybe. And kind of try to stir some of that, but it was really hard for me to do that.
And maybe it just could be interesting to notice that, okay, that this is an edge to really let myself be in my own ferocity. And then maybe take a like just do it with little, way that you don't have to go all like pick the thing you're the most angry about or whatever, like what would it be like to just take little bites of that? Too could be kind of an interesting, like you could just start with a push on your legs, just and then even from that you can feel your own kind of push. It's got a it has a push away quality. It has a no.
I liked what you said about taking back your sorry. So yeah, I think that kind of struck something with me. So maybe even starting with that, you know, taking that back and pushing back against that may be something to with.
Yeah, it turns out I'm not sorry about that. Mm-hmm. I should have never been, you know, I never needed to be sorry about that. It wasn't me.
Yeah. As a matter of fact, I wish I'd have been more of a brat. I wish I would have been more of a.
Yeah, I was in my anger.
Yes.
I was in my anger and I didn't know what to do with it. And I was, bumped into a defensive strategy of how can I appease the abuser? And that's what I did. Yeah, so to take that back was hugely freeing for me. Yeah. And it did, I mean, all of that did lead into me setting boundaries and I haven't seen my dad in 7-8 years now. So it did take me from a long ways from being the appeaser to being in my own power around that. And if I ever decide to go to visit, it will be with my own no in that I will fucking take myself somewhere else. And that's my commitment to my own inner parts too, is like, I will never put you in a situation where I don't have my own boundaries around that. So, yeah. Anyway, we're kind of at time, but Lori, if you want to add anything, just to.
Well, you know me, I go into my head, and so I've tried with one, and I thought, no, that guy's not even important enough to me to bother with. So then I went to my dad, and I'm now dealing with this feeble 87-year-old man. How can I be mad at him? Like all those kinds of things, you know? So yeah, I'll have to do it on my own. And
yeah.
But I like your idea of the edge. Like I don't have to go full ape on it. Just feel it.
Yeah, because that's what you want to experience, is that your own life force energy. And it might help to tell your parts, we don't have to do anything with this. I don't have to go, I don't got to go trip my 87-year-old dad and make it look like an accident. I don't have to go do anything with it.
Yeah.
It's just for me. To let myself, and maybe it's even starts with, this is shitty that I have to look after somebody, you know, feeling my own ferocity around that. But I don't have to, there's nothing I have to do with it.
Yeah. Thanks.
Yeah. Well, I hope that, at the very least you have it's a curiosity around, you know, our own anger, our relationship to our anger. What we were maybe denied in our own life force, in those two major things, sacred sexuality and sacred rage, and that we didn't have access to that life force, or we did, it was coming in and we had to do something with it and suppress it because it was too dangerous to ourselves and other people. And what if we could trust them and it would tell us about what we deeply care about and what we're a no to and what we are deeply a yes to. And that is, I think, a pretty good, yeah, we want to have a big yes. We need a big no. Thank you, everyone. I appreciate your time and your willingness to give that a go. I know it's a different kind of experience. But you know, one of the things that she said about it was like, it's her spiritual practice. That's kind of, there's quite a few different kind of things you can do, but that's for Maya Luna anyway, that's who I learned it from. And she does it as a way of getting in touch with that energy all the time. So I think, yeah, you can be whatever you want it to be, but it can be just a practice when you are angry that first you do that. First you drop into that sensation and then you see what clarity arises about what you want to do about it, if anything. So.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thanks, Becky.
Thanks for coming.
Thank you.
For letting me talk about things I deeply care about. Have a great rest of your day.
Thanks.
Bye.
Bye.
I'm glad that your cat showed his sacred, like his sacred no.
He wants out the closet and he wants out now. I knew right. When I let him in, I told him when he was in there, I said, okay, but you have to be in there for a whole hour. I swear he said yes, but it was clearly a no. So he did not wait it out. So yes.
There.
That's right. He's doing his instincts. He's a hell no, get me out of the closet.
That's right.
Okay. See you all.
Okay. Bye. Bye.